Okay, Professor Hildebrandt here, and in this video I'm going to be talking about the consumption function. So going back to the circular flow that we covered in an earlier chapter, we saw that disposable income, so households have earned their income, and so we had total earnings, or we called it GDP, and then they've paid their taxes and or received transfer payments, which gives them the value of net taxes. And then once they have that disposable income, they have two options. They either spend it, we call that consumption spending by households, or they save it, and the savings go to financial institutions. So those are just their two options. They either spend it or they save their money. So now we're going to look at specifically this relationship between disposable income and consumption. That's what we're going to call the consumption function. Okay, so it's a graph that looks something like this. It is an upward sloping line, label it here with a C, and it's showing the relationship between real consumption here on the vertical axis, and then down here, real disposable income. Okay. Now, recall also from earlier lectures that when we use the qualifying word real, which we're using here for both of our variables, that means it has been adjusted for price changes. Or we can call price changes just inflation. Okay, so we've taken the price change out. And so what this is saying is, you know, if our disposable income was, you know, 7 trillion, then we might be here at point A on the consumption function and have spending of 6.5 trillion. And if that were the case, then we would know that our savings was half a trillion, right? What can we say about the consumption function? There is a positive and stable relationship, okay, between disposable income and consumption. So positive, meaning that the variables move in the same direction. And here, right, disposable income is the independent variable, consumption is the dependent variable, okay? So consumption spending depends on the level of income that our households have. But as our income increases, so does consumption. By how much? It depends on the size of the MPC. And that is another video coming up later in this chapter. So if you haven't watched it yet, make sure you watch the video on calculating the MPC, marginal propensity to consume, and the MPS, the marginal propensity to save. Okay. There are other factors that impact our level of consumption spending. So let's draw our consumption function again. Again, showing the relationship between consumption and disposable income. So this is just showing the relationship between those two variables. If other relevant factors change, then it will cause our function to shift. Okay? It's going to be different, though, than when we were talking about shifts of this demand and supply curve in an earlier chapter. But then the shifts were left and right. Here, our shifts are going to be thought of as up or down, okay? And so if we want to show an increase in consumption, then we shift up, like to line C2, so that shows an increase. And what this is saying is regardless of the level of income, we're now spending more. So you see, if we have 1 trillion, 2, 3, 4, 5, or 6 trillion, regardless of that level, at each and every point, we are now spending more money. On the other hand, if we wanted to show a decrease in our consumption, then we would shift the line down to this red line. I'm labeling it as C3. Okay, so what are some of the things that will cause the consumption function to shift? We call these non-income determinants. Okay, and your textbook does a good job of listing these out and talking through them. So just really quickly here, it's things like household net wealth. So if the value of your assets goes up, even though your income hasn't changed, you spend more money. If real estate crashes, the value of your assets declines, you spend less money even if your income is the same. Okay, so that's one. Another one is the price level. So changes in the price level will affect our spending. Another is the interest rate. Think of what the interest rate represents, right? It is a penalty for spending money you don't have, for borrowing, and it's a reward for saving, okay? But it does affect changes in the interest rate will impact consumption spending. And then also consumer expectations of what's going to happen in the future. So expectations of future income, expectations of the future price level, expectations of the future interest rate. Again, the textbook does a really good job of outlining these, so make sure you take a look at that in the text.